Hi, welcome back to Wesbury 101. I'm Brian Wesbury, Chief Economist at First Trust Portfolios. Remember, we want to be the antidote to conventional wisdom. Well, I'm not asking you to feel sorry for me, but I have just finished reading the entire set of transcripts for all the Federal Reserve meetings during 2008. It's 1,865 pages of transcripts, 559,000 words. And to just put that into perspective, the Old Testament in the Bible has 593,000 words. And so I'm not asking you to feel sorry for me, but I'm here to report very, very briefly on what I found. And I guess the place to start is looking at this chart. Here's a picture of the S&P 500 during all 12 months of 2008 and the first 6 months of 2009. The red dots are all the Federal Reserve meetings. Some of them were actual meetings sitting around a table. Some were video conferences and some were just conference calls. But you can see that the Federal Reserve met consistently many, many times through 2008, and the market would occasionally stabilize but then would continue to fall. We all remember what happened: Bear Stearns, Lehman Brothers, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, AIG, Washington Mutual, Wachovia. All of those things happened during that year, and the Fed was meeting all along. And I want to just spend a few minutes about my general sense of their meetings. Now, first of all, these are really smart people. They understand monetary policy. The staff is really smart. They have incredible models of the economy. But if you go back to look at 2008, all during that year, there's a couple of characterizations that I would like to make. First of all, the Federal Reserve never understood until the very end of the year the dramatic nature of the problems facing the economy. In fact, in August of 2008, Ben Bernanke told the board that the total losses in aggregate that they had been able to add up that the banking system was going to have to realize was just $228 billion. That's not enough to take out the banking system. It's certainly not enough to take out the economy. And the Fed was putting in place TAF, TALF, commercial paper programs. They were supporting money market mutual funds. They were doing all of those things during this period. In fact, here's a little bit of Fed humor. One of the governors was listing the programs, TAF, TALF, CP, on and on. And Ben Bernanke interjected AEIOU, and that's all the vowels, obviously, and that was pretty funny, and they all laughed. And then the vice chairman, Geithner, came in and said, "Don't say IOU," and then they all laughed again. That's economist humor, if you want to know. But what's fascinating about looking back at 2008 is the Fed had just a couple of tools that it could use. It could use either inject liquidity into the system, or it could lower interest rates. Those are the two tools. Let's call those two hammers. And to the Fed, if all you have is a hammer, every problem looks like a nail. And in fact, William Dudley, in the middle of this whole process in September, if you look at this quote, said it very well. "Our strategy all along has been not to prevent the deleveraging or the unwinding that developed earlier, but to stretch it out a little so fewer things break." Obviously, he said, things are breaking even with all the tools that we've rolled out. So I think that just suggests that more force needs to be applied. In other words, Bill Dudley is saying, hey, we've hammered and hammered and hammered on this. It's things are still breaking. It's time for us to hammer even harder. And this gets at the heart of, I think, the error that the Federal Reserve made. They did not recognize the problems that mark-to-market accounting was causing the banking system. Mark-to-market accounting had been literally gotten rid of in 1938, and that's when the Great Depression ended. It was then put back into place in November of 2007, and we don't have enough reasons to get into why that happened in November of 2007. But what mark-to-market accounting does is it will take, let's say, a pool of 1,000 mortgages, 300 of them are not paying, 700 still are. And if I look at that as one credit instrument, 70% of the assets are still paying on time. In other words, that asset is worth at least 70 cents on a dollar if we use just the credit and the payment stream on that asset. The problem is that the market was pricing that asset at 10 or 12 cents on the dollar. This gap, this 50, 60, 70 cent loss that was put in because market prices, because of illiquid market prices were there, was forcing banks to take way more losses than they should. And the mark-to-market accounting rule was forcing them to mark these assets down to market prices, not to cash flow prices. These assets weren't as impaired as the market was suggesting they were. And as long as mark-to-market accounting was in place, problems in the economy were going to deteriorate. Banks were not going to trust each other. Assets weren't going to be sold. In fact, only 19 times during the 2008 meetings did the Fed mention mark-to-market accounting. They completely, I think, missed this problem. They knew it. They talked about it. But out of those 19 times that they mentioned it, 8 of them, almost half of them, were in the final meeting of the year, the December 15th, 2008 meeting. And in that meeting, Elizabeth Duke, a governor on the Fed, said this, and this was a very clear way of saying it. Every single bank that she talked to in her meeting was adamant about the evils of mark-to-market accounting and other than temporary impairment. There is a big diversion between market losses and credit losses, so that leads to bankers who are afraid to buy securities because they are worried about further marks, but they are also unwilling to sell securities because they don't believe that the current price reflects the true value. There is some speculation that the mark-to-market losses will absorb all of the $700 billion TARP capital that was just injected. In other words, she understood full well what the problem was, but the Fed was ignoring it. And at that December 15th meeting, the Federal Reserve became even more committed to using the hammer, more committed to quantitative easing. It cut rates again. And if you go back and look at our chart, what really fixed the stock market was that March 9th announcement by Barney Frank's committee that he was having a hearing on mark-to-market accounting. That's when the stock market bottomed. In fact, if you go back to early October of 2008, TARP was passed and quantitative easing was in full swing, and the market fell an additional 40% after those two things were put into place, after the Fed and the federal government and the Treasury were using their hammers to try and fix the system. The market still fell apart. And so when I go back and read these minutes of 2008, what it shows to me is that a groupthink developed at the Fed, that they believed that their liquidity tools and interest rates could fix any problem in the system, and they completely missed or ignored the problems that mark-to-market accounting had caused. That's why the crisis of 08 got so bad. That's why Federal Reserve policies are not the things that saved the economy. What finally saved it was moving mark-to-market accounting to the side, fixing its overly strict interpretation, allowing banks to use cash flow to value assets. And once that was done, the free market, the capitalist system, fixed the economy. And that leads me to one final point. Throughout the Fed minutes of 2008, there are many references to this idea that somehow the business model of our financial system was broken. There are many journalists, many intellectuals in America today that still believe this, that there was a broken financial model, way of doing business in the banking system that was broken in 2008. And they believed it needed to be fixed, and it could be fixed with a hammer, with the Fed's liquidity, with the Treasury's liquidity. But in reality, that system, that financial system, that business model wasn't broken. It was a bad accounting rule that caused it to break. Once that accounting rule was fixed, the economy came back. That's how we got into our current recovery. These minutes from 2008 unveil a lot, but one of the key things that they unveiled to me is that the Federal Reserve was naive about the problems that this accounting rule was causing and refused to look at it because all they really have is a hammer, and they felt like their hammer just needed to be used harder. Thanks so much for visiting Wesbury 101. We'll see you next time.